Good morning, students. How are you all? Hope all are you good and doing your study well. Today here we are going to start our next topic, that is molar specific heat. Last time I have told about this specific heat. Now here we are going to discuss about the molar specific heat. As the name suggests here, molar specific heat. So it is the amount of heat which is required to raise 1 mole of a substance through 1 degree Celsius to its temperature. So the amount of heat which is given to 1 mole of the substance, and that heat increases the temperature of 1 mole of the substance through 1 centigrade, and that much amount of heat is known as molar specific heat. And it depends upon the following factor. Here we can derive the formula for it. The amount of heat given is always directly proportional to the number of moles present in it, or it is also directly proportional to the change in temperature. And whenever equation 1 and 2 combine, you will get Q is directly proportional to N into dT. And now we can remove the sign of proportionality and put a constant, and the constant is here C, and C is called molar specific heat. And C can be written as, from here you can see, after cross multiplying, C is equal to Q by N into dT. And now with the help of this formula, you can write the units as well as dimension for the molar specific heat. Here Q is in joule, and N is in number of moles, and temperature is in Kelvin inverse. So therefore the SI unit for the molar specific heat is joule per mole per Kelvin. Now from here you can also write the dimension of a molar specific heat by putting the dimension of J, that is m1 l2 t-2, and the dimension of mole inverse m1 l2 t-2, and mole inverse as it is, and Kelvin inverse as it is. So the dimension for molar specific heat is m1 l2 T-2, mole inverse, temperature inverse. Now the next types of molar specific heat. Molar specific heat is basically of two types. First is molar specific heat at constant pressure. As the name suggests here, in this case pressure remains constant. And molar specific heat, again the amount of heat which is required to raise the temperature of one mole of the substance through 1 centigrade whenever the pressure kept constant. So this is the amount of heat which is required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of the substance, but in this case pressure remain constant because it is specific heat at constant pressure. So here pressure remain constant. So whenever pressure is kept constant, and we have 1 mole of the gas, and we are given a heat to it, and that heat raises its temperature through 1 degree centigrade, and that heat is known as molar specific heat at constant pressure, and it is represented by Cp. Now the second type is molar specific heat at constant volume. Again, specific heat means amount of heat given to raise the temperature of the 1 mole of the substance through 1 degree Celsius, but in this case volume remain constant at constant volume, and therefore it is called molar specific heat at constant volume and represented by Cv. And mathematically we have the formula C for Q by N. N is here 1 into dT, and it is represented by Cv. So Cv is equal to q by dt. So again, the molar specific heat at constant volume is basically that much amount of heat which is required to raise the 1 mole of the substance its temperature through 1 degree centigrade. Now the next term is latent. Latent means hidden, hidden heat or latent heat. This is the heat which is given to a metal at its melting point or boiling point, and this heat uses to change the state of a matter without changing its temperature. So latent heat is that much amount of heat which is required to change the state of a matter at its melting point or boiling point without changing its temperature. For example, whenever liquid starts boil at that temperature, whenever we supply a heat, and that heat, if it does not increase the temperature of the liquid but changes 1 gram of the liquid directly into vapor without changing its temperature, and that heat is called latent heat of vaporization. In the same way, whenever at the melting point, when the liquid melt, then we are providing heat to the solid which is melting, and that heat does not change the temperature of the material but changes 1 gram of the solid into liquid without changing its temperature, and that is called latent heat of fusion. So it is of two types, that is latent heat of fusion and latent heat of vaporization. Latent heat means hidden heat which is given to a substance to change its state without changing its temperature at its melting or boiling point. At a boiling point, it is called latent heat of vaporization, and at melting point, it is called latent heat of fusion, which means whenever we provide heat to a material and it does not change the temperature but it changes the state of a solid into liquid at its melting point without changing its temperature, and that is called latent heat of fusion. In the same way, latent heat of vaporization, the amount of heat given to the liquid at its boiling point, and this heat changes the 1 gram of liquid into vapor without changing its temperature, and that much heat is called latent heat of vaporization. Now the next is thermal conductivity. Thermal conductivity can be determined since we have delta Q by delta T. Delta Q by delta T here represent the rate by which heat transfer, means how much heat is transferring in unit time, and that is called the rate of heat transfer. Whenever we provide heat to a material body, then the rate of transfer of heat depends upon the following factor. First of all, delta Q by delta T, which means the rate of transfer of heat, is directly proportional to area in contact. For example, from where the heat is providing, if area is large heat will transfer. And second factor, it is directly proportional to the change in temperature. Whenever the temperature increases, the more heat will transfer. And third factor, it is directly proportional to the length. Inversely proportional to the length, which means it is inversely proportional to 1 by delta x. So if the length of the conductor is large, then heat takes large time to transfer from one point to another point. So it is inversely proportional to the length of the conductor, directly proportional to the area cross section, and directly proportional to the change in temperature from one point to the another point. If there is a large temperature difference between the two points from where heat has to transfer from one point to another, then heat transfer more speedily. So these are the factor which affect the rate of heat transfer. It basically affect by three factor. First one is area. Area is large, then rate of heat transfer will be large. If temperature difference is more, then the rate of heat transfer will be more. But if the length of the conductor is large, then it will take large time to transfer heat from one point to the another, and that's why it is inversely proportional to the length of the conductor. So these are the three factors which affect the rate of heat transfer. So after recombining these three factors, we will get delta Q by delta T is basically directly proportional to the area, and directly proportional to the temperature, and inversely proportional to the delta X. So if you will remove the sign of proportionality, we will put a constant here, and that constant is called K, and it is called thermal conductivity of a material. And thermal conductivity of the material from here can be defined with the help of this formula by cross multiplying. You can calculate the value of K. So from here you can calculate the value of K, and K is given as delta Q by delta T divided by A into delta T by delta X. So here you can see the thermal conductivity of a material is basically represent the rate of heat transfer per unit area, per unit temperature gradient, because here temperature is divided by length. So this factor become temperature gradient, and that's why the thermal conductivity capital K is represents the rate by which heat transfer per unit area, per unit temperature gradient. So this is the definition for the thermal conductivity. So thermal conductivity is basically the rate at which heat transfer per unit area, per unit temperature gradient, and you can calculate the units for thermal conductivity with the help of this formula. You can see from here. So by putting the various values, you can calculate the dimension. Since the value of heat is in joule, and change in temperature is in per second, and then area is in meter square, and then this temperature gradient, which means temperature by length, means Kelvin by meter, and after simplifying you will get the unit for the thermal conductivity, and that is joule per second per meter per Kelvin. So today you have to do up to here. Thank you, students.